Hello guys, in this video we are going to transform this blade server. It's an HP ProLiant BL480c into a standard working desktop computer. As you can see here, lots of things will be going on. This thing had 2 3 GHz Xeons inside, 5160s. They were used in another one of my projects. You can check out that video on my channel. So I will be putting instead 2 5150s, a little bit lower clock speed. And it had 20 GB of RAM. It will have only 2 GB of RAM. This is what's left. And no hard drive. I'm going to put one laptop hard drive, 120 GB. I'm going to do my best to put an optical drive in this thing. Although, let me just show you. These things in laptop optical drives are SATA, but they do not have the same plug as hard drives. So I will need to modify something to be able to connect this thing inside, and hopefully I'm going to use 2 of these bays for the optical drive and 2 bays for hard drives, but I will be putting only one in at the moment. We will see about that. This thing doesn't have any USB, as you can see here, so yeah, no chance of using that. It has one internal, but I don't think it can be used for a network card, sound card or stuff like that. So I bought this thing. It doesn't even have VGA out. Look at this weird connector. Let me try and put it in here. So this thing will be going in front of here, in front of the PC, and it has these outputs, of course only 2 USBs. So this is where this thing comes in. It will be plugged into one of them. Let's just put this thing out once more, and everything USB will be plugged into that thing. And yeah, it also doesn't have a PSU internally. This thing was meant to go into racks and connect to other boards that gave it all the information, the voltage, the current required to operate. So yeah, I'm going to try and modify it to work as a standalone computer. And there is no real reason, but I want to try and see if I can do it. Simple as that. So as a power supply, I have this Dell one. Let me bring it a bit closer. This is outputting 12 volts at a maximum of 18 amps. Hopefully it's enough. It will be close, but hopefully it's enough. And obviously it doesn't have a standard plug in the back, so I'm going to try and use this thing. As you can see, this is ripped up from a motherboard, and I found a place on it where the connector from the Dell power supply actually plugs in correctly. So I'm going to cut it and solder this onto the computer. And yeah, hopefully everything works. Who knows? We'll see. So, let's start tinkering. First thing, this must go in somehow. I will show the back in a moment. This is the back of it. You can see where it would connect to other boards, obviously, and this is where it would get its power from, through these thick wires. So in full configuration with 4 hard drives, a ton of memory, really powerful CPUs, this thing draws lots of power, but hopefully in my light configuration my PSU will be enough to handle it, although that remains to be seen, obviously. So first thing, I need to remove the things that I will not use again, meaning this and most likely this thing, and try to solder something directly to these cables. So let's see how that goes. To remove these 2 big connectors, you simply need to break this sheet of metal on top. from the lower part, you break it like this, and then you will have lots of these small connectors that simply, if you bend them just a little bit like this, then you can slide them out slowly. They will eventually, obviously not on video, because why would they work on video? Let me try and force this one a little bit. They are just this one is stuck. Okay, it came out. As you can see, they are just pushed into the motherboard with some elastic pins, so they are not permanently attached, but obviously they need to be pursued a little bit, because they went in there and stayed in there for lots of years. So I'm going to do this to both connectors. Obviously this one also needs to be unscrewed. So this one is also out, and I will tinker with the, it seems it's only drawing power to through this side. That's somewhat good for me. Actually, I don't even think it matters. So yeah, and undo this. So let's continue. This thing has a screw in the middle underneath. I broke it off initially. Let me show you. Hopefully you can see the other one. You just pull on it and it will break and move. Okay, so it broke off right there, which is perfect. And then you simply put it into this position, slide this and lock in that screw, and then turn it around. Of course, make sure you push on the screw and not on the motherboard, as we do not want to damage the motherboard underneath. So only on the screw head, and it will come off in the end. I decided I need some open space in this area to put a big fan, so this connector that looked like this one had to go. Basically I just ripped it apart. It's soldered, so you cannot do anything, and it's also made of blades like the other one, but these blades are soldered, so the only thing, push it in front and wiggle it until it breaks. That's the only thing that you can do. So if you do not 100% need to do this, I recommend you leave it alone. And now I will have to check every single connection to make sure it's not shorted with something else from the wiggling. So that will be quite annoying, but I really needed an open space here, because this thing, for example, okay, it's off. This thing again can be off in a moment, and this one. So this area will be free for a thicker fan now. So let's do that. To open up this plug, because it's quite hard to break it up, you need to remove the front. That one you will break. It's something like that, stuck in there. So you need to pull it out, and then you can see some tabs right there that will release these two metal connectors. So one way or another, I'm gonna get in there and release them. The red one is out, so that's perfect. Black one is out also. And what I want to do, because as you can see these wires are really thick and I like them, let me just take this a bit. These are really thin, so impossible to solder this onto this. So I will solder more wires onto the connections here, cover them in solder, put them inside here and crimp this onto them like it's crimped here. So that will be a good connection. And this, I don't know, I will glue it here or somewhere on the bottom. I don't know, I will glue it somewhere, but this will remain. They are thick but flexible, so they are good cables. As you might see from the marks, at this point I had several attempts of cutting this connector to the required dimension, because as you can see, most likely this thing has shorted pins on the back, because many wires brought the same voltage to certain areas. But for sure I will not need those shorted pins, so I need to get this connector out. So in the end, the only way was to clamp it in place onto this particle board and use a hot air gun, and hopefully I can take it like this out. But obviously I will not use my hand, I will try to do this with various tools, because I will burn myself. So yeah, let's do this, but most likely off video, because this thing makes lots of noise. Progress was made. In the end I decided to solder some wires directly to the connector and then to the thick wires. I removed, because these were pairs, two black ones, two red ones, so I removed one of each. My wires are thinner than this, so that's not really good, but they are really short, so I don't think it will be a problem. And either way, I don't think this connector can handle more power than these wires that I put here can, so we are set. And let me just show you, because this PSU doesn't power on by itself. I found a website, maybe you can see it here, pinoutguide.com, and for my PSU it gives the pinout, and I just needed to short pin 8 to any of the ground pins. I shorted it to all of them, actually right up here, that's pin 8 in the corner, so it's shorter to all, shorted to all. And in the lower part all 12 volt rails are connected together, because it's only one, but it comes in through three connections. So yeah, that's about it. And if you need the pinouts, now it just changed to pinouts.ru, you have tons of pinouts in this website for every single thing that you can imagine related to computers. So that is awesome. I'm going to put this site in the description of the video. So at this point, let me zoom out, turn this thing around and give it just a quick burst of power to see if anything happens. I still don't have memory and CPUs in. And yeah, I don't know if you can see here, let me move you a little bit, we have some light up LEDs. So let's power it on off again. And yeah, I'm going to start putting memory and CPUs back in, because I don't want to work on it a lot more unless I see signs of real life, like powering on. So let's do that now. The sockets are ready to receive the CPUs. I need to clean the heat sinks, apply new thermal paste and close everything up. And I'm going to show you how to open this thing and close it up, because I didn't really remember how to open it up, so I could film it this time. But next time I will show you. So let's continue, start cleaning. Everything is clean. Make sure even the pads are clean. So let's start putting these things back in. You search for the marked corner on the CPU and the socket. Put it in place. Lock it in. And first CPU is done. Although I don't really like this lock, it doesn't seem to grab really well, but yeah, that's their design, can't do anything about it. Clean. Put it in place. Lock it in. That's about it. CPU coolers clean. They are extremely heavy, almost like a solid copper block. And if you look at it, where do they show up? They even have heat pipes running through them. So that's pretty awesome. Now, if I would actually remember the correct position, but I really don't. I think it should be like this because I will go through it like that. But I still need to put in thermal paste, so I'll be back in a second. Thermal paste in place. And I finished it. It was just enough to do the CPU, so I need to buy some more. Trusty old MX2. Cheap and gets the job done. So hopefully, as you can see, they have some pins that fit in the proper position. You can see they are not aligned, so you must be careful how you place this thing in. It fell in place. Let's put the other one in. I think it's in place. Now you just need to, I bumped the camera. Start tightening screws in a cross pattern as always. It's not going to be really easy. Do not put your screwdriver through the motherboard. That would suck. On some sockets, mainly in laptops, the order of tightening these screws is even marked on the socket itself or on the heatsink, so that makes things way easier. Yeah, this one I over tightened by mistake in the first place, so that's not ideal, but it's a bit too late now. So tightened and in place. Let me get the memory now. Memory is in. One in slot A, one in slot B. If I would have only this CPU, then both of them should be in slot A here and slot A here. So 1A, 4A. But I have two CPUs, so each of them I think needs one stick of RAM. We will see that. If it doesn't like it, it will tell us for sure. So at this point, let's try and put this thing back on. Not really 100% still on how this fits, but I think it slides like that. Yep, that's it. To get it out, you have, let me just show you more on this part maybe. You have this thing here. It's a lever, it pushes it out, one on the other side, and it all slides out. But we want it back in, so slide in place until you hear some nice clicks and you are sure it's in place. That's about it. Let me discharge myself a little bit on the ground there. Let's put this board back in place. As you can see, it has a big connector right there that will connect in that one. Okay, dropped it. That's not ideal once again. But as I always say, don't do the stupid things that I do. Take from me only the good parts. So this thing is still not connected here. It's not going to connect easily, so I must look way more at it, way closer. Guys, I freaking did it. This thing is working. As you can see, it's turned down again. I had some issues. This board, I do not know really why, but it was really bent out of shape. Actually, two of the LEDs fell off from it, so I need to try and solder them back on, and it was not making contact. So this thing was kind of trying to power on, but I didn't have any lights on the front and it didn't give me a video signal. As you can see now, I have a perfect video signal, so I know for sure that this thing is really working. So the main issue now is another one. I need to try and put everything back together and for this to still work. That's going to be a bit tricky, but let's do it. Somebody worked on this thing at a certain point in time, and this board was not into its correct position and it was badly bent downwards. So that is why nothing was working. Now I straightened up as best as I could the board and also the metal, and I think the moment I will plug it in to the port on this motherboard, it will straighten itself up and in time it will be perfect. But I think they forced this board into its place. That's why some LEDs were ripped of it. But weirdly enough, they were LEDs for these network cards that actually will never work again, because I cannot use those connections. They were going to the back of this computer in the ports that I already took out, so I didn't even bother gluing them, soldering them back in place. We have all we need. These are okay all, and this is okay, so it's good. Now let's put this thing back. Okay guys, made some progress with the top cover. With this oscillating saw, we cut this hole, made four holes. I will put these rubber grommets in them, use these screws to attach the fan from underneath. I'll modify this thing so I can glue it in place on top, and yeah, that should be about it. So let's continue. Okay guys, as you can see, the fan is 99% finished. I just have to connect it directly to 12 volts. I used a glue gun to cover all the contacts, make sure this is strong enough so it will not break. As you can see, I can move the board with it, no problem. Covered up all the holes that we don't use, so you cannot put it wrong. It will only be able to be inserted here. And the fact that as you can see, it has this thing here, it's for sure that you cannot try to put it other way around, although it doesn't even enter because they have weird shapes. So you only can put this thing in here like this. And yeah, that's about it. I've given up on putting an optical drive in this thing because I have to do lots of modifications to put it in here, because as you might know, laptop optical drives do not have the standard SATA connector. For the data part, the pins are smaller, fewer of them, so yeah. And I realized that maybe this controller doesn't even recognize optical drives. So I'm doing a lot of work with no possibility to test it until it's completely finished. And maybe it still doesn't work. So optical drive goes away. Yeah, I have the network card, sound card, USB hub. Yeah, that's about it. I will try to put this card. It has an internal USB here, but that USB might only work for USB drives. So only for data. Maybe it doesn't work for network, for sound cards. If it works, this will be internal and only the sound card external, but that remains to be seen. And of course I need to close all of these holes to make sure it only draws air to the front through the CPU heat sinks. And yeah, this looks pretty good. Let me try and show you. You can see the connector that I ripped off. It's covered now because it was clearly not clearing up for the fan. The fan is really glued in place, so it will never move. And yeah, that's about it. So let's continue. The cables are soldered in place, positive, negative. As you can see, glued in place once again. This thing is glued all around, so the cables cannot break. You have enough length. If you need to do an upgrade to this thing, you can set this aside, no problems. Hard drive is pushed into its connection, and it has some foam between it and this top part, metal part, to keep it in place. It cannot move because I don't have the caddies, so all hard drives will need to be put in place with basically the same thing. So yeah, that's about it. So what can I say? And if you are thinking, okay, but this fan will run always when this PSU is connected to the mains, yes, because this PSU is always working. As you can remember, I shorted two pins here to tell it when it's plugged in always to be working. Normally this PSU has a standby. The original computer that uses it knows how to make this PSU standby. This thing doesn't know. So it's something like, I think it's even better, because you know the fan is working. Oh, I forgot to unplug the PSU. And yeah, that's about it. It would have been really hard to do it any other way, so that's what we have and that's what we work with. So let's continue. Let me just say once again, for the BL480c you need this deep switch number 5, the one right there, to be set to on, all others to off if you want to run this outside the original rack. It also works for BL60. I'm not really sure if still number 5, but one of those deep switches needs to be on. And for 680, it should have a jumper. So you just connect a jumper to it. It will have somewhere just like this one, for example. Just two pins somewhere on the board in this area around here. You can see here lots of glue strands. I need to throw this away. Somewhere around this area of the controller, you need to connect that so it will work outside the rack. I just wanted to tell you that once again. One more thing, this PSU has 18 amps at 12 volts. It's barely. It will work with this setup, but barely. If you want something better, go for a higher amp PSU at 12 volts. But I consider that this is enough for what I will have in this thing. And even if I add some hard drives and maybe 1-2 sticks of RAM, it will work. With fully populated RAM and two processors, two bigger, more powerful processors, then problems. But I'm not going to do that, so for me it will work without problems. Front is covered up really nicely with this type of tape. It's really strong, it glues really well, and this doesn't even prevent the top from being taken off. So all this part that remains open, all of this air goes through the CPUs. That's how this thing is designed. So that is perfect for me. For laptop hard drives you don't really need too much cooling. So let's try and close the bag. And on these sides, I think I'm going to put just standard scotch tape, transparent one, because this is not really important. If it breaks, yeah, whatever, not a lot of air going through here. Maybe I don't even put anything. I will see if it heats up or not like this. But the bag must be closed. Backside is also closed up. As you can see here, no problems. I put a tape from the lower part and turn it around like this, and it also goes to the sides a little bit, and the top one just from here onto the other one, and they meet here in the middle for about this much. So that is awesome. Absolutely zero, about this much, maybe I was optimistic. You can see here, hopefully, can you see? I think you can see here, both sides the same. So that should be enough, no problems, and there are no big holes anymore. So this fan should be able to take enough air through the CPUs to keep them cool. Next thing that I can do, run it and see what happens. So let's get to that. And of course this can be taken off. It still allows for the backside to be flipped. In the worst case scenario, you only peel it from the top part from this one and do your thing and then put it back. That's simple. Obviously I forgot all about the connector, so I cut a little hole for it, the minimum possible. And of course I needed to remove that latch that, honestly, it was just preventing you to put it the other way around because it had nothing into what to latch. But because of the shape of these pins, you cannot put it in other way around, so it doesn't even matter anymore. And that's done. Let's power it on. Okay guys, I've actually discovered that this USB port accepts anything, not only USB drives. So I cut a little bit in the side here. It was really hard. Let me show you what I used. This little flat saw with a metal blade on it. So yeah, that was tricky. Filed it down. Made a cut here, as you can see, longer because this thing slides. And now my intention is to use this thing, put it here like this and glue it in place, and now the cover can come down and it will not cut the wire. So yeah, everything else is running perfectly. As you can see, I can open it up, work on it, so pretty good. Let's continue. Hardware side of things is 100% finished. If you need this cable that I have here, hopefully this part number will help you. Don't really know if you can see, but I think it's in focus. Should be in focus. Something on the back, but most likely this is not important. The other side is the important one. So I'm going to throw that away because I never like to have those things on the cables. As you can see, sound card is working. I have my receiver for my mouse here. I have my keyboard here, so this is working perfectly. Yeah, let me just show you. And here I have a Wi-Fi card and a standard network card. Just the Wi-Fi just for working on the computer at this moment. Only the standard one will remain in this computer. The weird thing is, I don't know if you can see it here, the image seems to be flickering. It's doing this for about the first time I started it, and it's doing it exactly the same. So I don't know, is it normal for this PC? maybe it's because I don't have all the drivers installed, it's running on the standard Windows one. I don't know. I'm going to tinker with it a little bit and we will see. But the hardware side all finished. It's a bit noisy, of course, but it's cooling two CPUs, ECC RAM.
Yeah.
And this PSU is heating up, but I don't know, less than a laptop PSU, for example. So that is good in my opinion. It should be okay. So yeah, let's play around with the software for a little bit. And this thing, as you can see, I glued it on the side and it's staying here no matter what. So that is perfect. Okay guys, it's been a few weeks since I had time to work on this thing because of some work related stuff. So now I'm going to finish it and I have some things to tell you about it. It was moving really slowly, everything was really slow, and with these two CPUs this thing should fly. So something was not quite I can get this thing to align properly. Something was not quite right. So I decided to try another Windows version. From previous experience, Windows 64-bit, if you only have 2 GB of RAM, it sometimes creates problems. So I decided to put Windows 10 Home 32-bit. Problem with Windows 10 Home is that it didn't see one of the CPUs, so it only knows one CPU, not two CPUs. So now I'm back to Windows 10 Pro, but 32-bit version, and as you can see, even this thing is, if it's still working, it's still installing stuff. I just finished installing it. Hard drive is almost at max, CPUs actually pretty busy, but you can still do stuff. I don't even have a driver for the GPU now. Maybe it's installing something, I have no idea what it's doing actually, but you can still do stuff with Windows 10 Pro 64-bit. It was dead, so you couldn't click on anything, you couldn't move anything. It was completely dead. So if you have a computer with only 2 GB of RAM, put the 32-bit version on it, and if you upgrade the memory over 3 GB, then reinstall Windows and put the 64-bit version. If you put that from the start, your computer will work like a pig. It will not do anything. There are really weird cases when sometimes it barely works, but it's almost usable. But in some cases, like this one, for me, it doesn't work. You can try to shut down applications, spend a lot of time and try and make it work. It just doesn't want to work. It doesn't have enough memory and it uses the hard drive like mad. And this is a laptop hard drive, so it's quite slow and yeah, not good for you. So at this point, I'm going to let it settle a little bit. Let it finish what it's doing, install the last programs, and I don't know, run some tests. But everything seems to be working. And obviously put the drivers back for these two things that are not even plugged now. So yeah, let's get to it. Okay guys, so I'm back. This is another fresh Windows 10 install because I managed to break the other one. Basically, I found the drivers for these things. These, for example, are the two integrated network controllers. You can also see part of them here. And for this, it's ILO, something from HP. Either way, it's a server thing, and because we are not connecting to the big rack anymore, these things are useless. And the bad part is that they actually break your Windows install. Your Windows install will go into a boot loop, recovery loop and it will never work. If you are just wondering how I found these drivers without knowing what they are, you click on properties, then on details, hardware IDs, and you search for this, for example, 0E11B204. And you will eventually, with forums, with links, you will find your driver. I found drivers for, I think, Windows 7 or some Vista, but they worked. So Windows recognized them, installed them, but again, they bricked my Windows install. So at this point, what I'm not using, I decided to disable. You can see it's disabled. And yeah. The network USB card, you can see it here, installed. This thing that came with it, the CD, actually has the wrong drivers, if you can believe it, but yeah, they're Chinese. What would you expect from a cheap Chinese thing? There are some drivers for a joystick and some gamepad, so this is going to be thrown away, useless. And yeah, Windows found the driver online for this thing, installed it. For the USB, it had USB sound card, it already had the driver, so everything in my opinion is good. These things you do not even use because you don't have an output, something to plug into anymore. They were at the back where we actually removed all the connectors. So now we are completely using this USB and we have this little sound card. As you can see, CPU is recognized perfectly, even here. And yeah, Windows still working like mad on updates and whatever it's doing after fresh installs. You can see even my antivirus is doing some things now, and I think something Chrome did, but maybe it finished. Yeah, Chrome thing, it finished. So I will wait for it to lower its usage on our hard drive, and then do some tests, and hopefully this time we really are finished with this thing. And another thing, this time I made two partitions. We have a C and a D, and as you can see, I already made an image backup with Windows just installed, with drivers but without programs. And now that I installed actually programs, when it will finish doing whatever it's doing, I will use this thing and create a system image, and I will back up our C install on the D drive again, just to be sure that I'm not going to lose it once again and have to install everything from the start. So yeah, that's about it. I'm going to cancel this and wait for this thing to settle. Okay, still not finished. This thing managed to destroy my Windows install once again, but I put it back from the previous backup that I made. So I decided to disable Windows updates altogether for the moment, because it's updating something that's killing my install. Without being able to enter my install, I do not know which of the updates is the culprit. So I will show you how to reach this in local group policy editor, configure automatic updates and set it to disable. As you can see here, if the status for the policy is set to disabled, any updates must be downloaded and installed manually. This is exactly what I want. Don't search for updates for me. I don't want any at the moment. So normally I think it's not configured or something like that. You can set it to enable, and you have some options here. You can manually download if you want and install them. Probably this is the best option, and install them one by one and see which one causes the trouble. But I don't have time at the moment, so set it to disable. Give it an apply, and this should kill automatic updates. Okay, just to see how you reach this thing in basically, okay, this is what you need to run: gpedit.msc
click on it and it brings you here. Here you go to computer configuration, administrative templates, Windows components, and way low, Windows updates, configure automatic updates, edit. And to disable them, go to disabled and OK. So I can exit now. Automatic updates should be killed at the moment. And another thing, let me just show you. You go to system, advanced system settings, hardware, device installation settings. Normally it's set to yes, and it will download for you drivers and install the drivers if there are new drivers from your for your components. But in my case, maybe a driver is killing it, or an update, I don't know. So I want to kill automatic driver updates. So save changes, it's set to no, it will not download anything for me, and okay. And at this point, as I have this installed, it should remain like this, working without any problems. And now again, I need to install all other programs by myself. So let's do that. Okay guys, so this thing is finally running in its final form. You can see the USB card here, powered on, working. The network card here, it's installed and functioning, but it's not connected. At the moment we are connected with USB Wi-Fi stick. The PSU, it's heating up, but I don't know. Maybe you know that at 50 degrees Celsius, you feel burning. Well, I feel this only hot. So this thing is probably at about 40 degrees Celsius. So absolutely no problem. And that is after I put this thing to a really tough test to see how much it heats up. So no problem, the PSU will handle it. And yeah, what else? Let me just show you what's the status here with the programs and drivers and stuff like that. Okay, Windows 10 Pro is running perfectly, 32-bit version, because we only have 2 GB of RAM at the moment. If you have more, put the 64-bit version on it. Let's see, drivers, in the end it seems that even disabling these things will make Windows not load anymore. So I will just leave them uninstalled. And Windows is the possibility of Windows to update the drivers is disabled. So it will not do anything to them. They are not installed and they will remain like this until somebody wants to install them. But better not, because it will kill Windows. But I also made just a backup image on D drive. You have this thing here, so in case Windows gets destroyed again, it takes about 10 minutes to get it working in this exactly exact configuration that it has now. So that's no problem anymore, it's solved. And yeah, what else? You can see with stuff running in the background, it's handling it pretty well. Memory not used a lot. With 64-bit it would be used about 1.5-1.6 gigabytes, so half of gigabyte less with 32-bit version that we are using now. CPUs recognized, no problems there. You can see here, so two processors, everything fine. So yeah, that's about it with Windows and with drivers. You can still probably see the flickering. I'm 99.99% sure this is because my stupid monitor. Maybe if you watch my other videos, you can see that this monitor sometimes misbehaves with certain graphic cards. It just doesn't like, I don't know, the resolution, the refresh rate. It doesn't like something. If I put it in 800 by 600, for example, it will not do this anymore. So yeah, and sometimes when I revert, it will actually not do it anymore, even in this resolution. But now it's doing it, because why not, I'm filming. So let me just try and give it an apply, let it stay for a while like this, keep changes. not flickering, and then try again. Maybe it will stop. Nah, doesn't want to do it this time, but please believe me, it stopped even by itself. So 99.99% my monitor is to blame. Old and bad, but I will use it until it dies. The other thing, you can see here we have audio, no problem. Everything running normally. Pretty hard to hear it because of the bloody fan, but yeah, it is what it is. What else? The GPU has 32 megs of memory. Let me just show you that. I don't even know why I didn't have this thing powered on. 32 megabytes. It's an ES1000 and it's running the Microsoft Basic Display Adapter, and I'm not going to do anything about it. It will run like this. The only thing that I'm not 100% sure about is this. You can see after a really hard test in this room at the moment, I'm on my balcony. My workspace is my balcony actually. It's really hot. We have a heat wave in my country at the moment, so there are about 30 degrees Celsius in this room at the moment when I'm doing this test, and it got a bit hot. It didn't thermal throttle, it didn't shut down, so it's not over what it can do, above what it can do, but a bit hot. Now another problem, you can see these two temperatures for one CPU and for the other. And 99% of the time these two temperatures are exactly 20 degrees apart. So this is something really weird to me. Normally, I don't know, maybe because of the airflow you can cool one of the CPUs better than the other. But for them to be that close most of the time, something's not right. So I'm thinking that actually this CPU reports badly its temperature. Because I think if it actually hit 97 degrees, this motherboard will thermal throttle, will do something. So I'm thinking that actually this is the real temperature of both CPUs, but this one is reporting 20 degrees C more than it should. I have no idea why. I tried to run this thing with its lid taken off for a while, and I tried with my hand quickly to test between the heat sinks. From what I can feel, they have the same temperature, both of them. So that makes me think that something's fishy around here, and this is the real temperature. Because if it hit this, the motherboard will do something to stop it from going this high temperature. So, yeah. But again, it's running absolutely normally. And yeah, this thing is finally done. So in the end, the software was even more problematic than the hardware, but at the moment, realizing that the drivers are the only problem, I could even let Windows start updating again, but just prevent it updating its drivers. But for the moment, I will leave it like this. No updates, no driver updates, and it's running perfectly in my opinion. And this is it. It's a weird thing. But I don't know, it's better than actually throwing it away, because that would be the only other thing that you could do with this. So an adapter, some USB thingies, and yeah, you have a running computer. I think I bumped something here, you could see the monitor shut down for a second. So yeah. Let me just show you how this thing shuts down, because it doesn't really shut down like a normal computer. You click on shut down, but because everything is hardwired, the fan will not shut down. And the only thing you can see shutting down when Windows shuts down is this USB thingy. So the monitor is already off, but the computer is actually not off yet. Now it is off. But if you would look at, let me just try and move the camera a bit and zoom for you on the button. You maybe can see this thing is still green. So to properly shut down the motherboard, you hold on this thing for about 5 seconds. and now it's amber, and now the computer is actually shut down. So this thing now is off, and I can kill its power without anything bad happening to it, and it's silenced once again. So hey guys, thanks for watching, hopefully you enjoyed this video, hopefully it helps you do something like this for yourself if you want. And yeah, subscribe, check out my other videos, comment and ask whatever you need in the comments, and see you again in the next one. Bye!